Will the clerk please call the roll?
Mayor Larson.
Here.
Commissioner Angel.
Here.
Commissioner Arbke. Commissioner Jennings.
Here.
Commissioner Peck.
Here.
Please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance and a moment of silence.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. At this time, we'll have the citizens forum. This is where anyone from the audience can come up and speak on something not on today's agenda. Please come to the podium and give us your name and address. Seeing that there is no one, we'll go ahead and move on. There are no awards and proclamations. There are no public hearings and items scheduled for a certain time, so we will move on to the consent agenda.
Item 6.1, approve the minutes of October 19th, 2009.
Mayor, I make a motion that we approve the minutes from October 19th, 2009 as the consent agenda.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve the consent agenda as presented. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay. Motion passes 4-0. Development business.
Item 7.1, application number PDD 81-4K, requesting an amendment to the Central Mall PDD to allow a pylon sign on property address as 2259 South 9th Street. Sub-item 7.1A, first reading ordinance number 09-10522.
Mr. Andrew.
Thank you, Mayor and Commissioners. Back in May of 1982, the City Commission passed an ordinance that created a planned development district for the Central Mall. And it is a mixed-use district as it consists of both residential and commercial zoned property. The mall itself occupies Lot 1, Block 1. The zoning was put in place in 1982. The final plan for construction and layout was approved in 1986. In 1990, the Sears store was added onto the east side. And the result of that is that you have the mall proper, and then there are seven retail outlots. There are four office outlots along Magnolia Road, and there's a multifamily area to the north of the mall, north of the Dillard store, which is undeveloped, and then there were single family lots platted to the east. The idea was to ring the mall with residential that would serve as a buffer between the mall and the existing residential neighborhoods to the north and to the east. In 1995, the Chapel Ridge Apartments came in, and there's 296 apartments that were constructed east of the mall. In 2007, an amendment was approved to allow a sign out along 9th Street to serve a future mall tenant, which was identified as the Old Navy store. That was approved, but no sign was ever put up at that time. The application we're dealing with here has to do with the south sign located at the south entrance to the mall. It's identified on the drawing there. It's located in the center of a median island. And back in 1986, when the mall was under construction, a permit was applied for, and the elevation that was attached was for a 40-foot tall pylon sign. The permit was issued with a stipulation or condition that the sign erected had to comply with C3 sign regulations. I said we looked at it in retrospect. That's probably not the best way to communicate that, but it evidently didn't get communicated well to the mall or the contractor, and they put up the 40-foot sign that was originally proposed. That's been there for 23 years. Now they want to take it down and replace it with a new sign, and the sign they're proposing is 140 square feet with a 72 square foot electronic message center reader board underneath, and the proposed height is 40 feet. And we informed them that the limitation was 30 feet originally and still is, and that they could replace it, but the sign would either have to be 30 feet tall or they could apply to have approval for a 40-foot sign. So that's what they've done here. The mall is currently in receivership, so we have a mall manager, which is the Farbman Group, and then the mortgage holder is the Wachovia Bank, and they are seeking purchasers for the mall at this time. So this request went forward to the Planning Commission, and again, the sign had been there for 23 years, and we pointed out that in a couple cases, the Lowe's site down at Schilling and 9th and the Kohl's site over on 9th Street are both C3 properties with a 30-foot limit, but they're both planned districts, and the Planning and City Commissions in those cases allowed for increased sign height in exchange for limits on the number of signs. From a zoning standpoint, there actually is no limit on the number of pole signs presently that the Central Mall can have. And so the recommendation of the Planning Commission was that this 40-foot tall sign be approved, that no additional pole signs be allowed on 9th Street beyond the two that exist. They recommended that the amendment that was characterized in 2007 as being necessary in order to get Old Navy to sign a lease, that proved not to be correct, and so in their mind there wasn't any reason for that sign anymore since Old Navy chose to use a wall sign. So that was the recommendation that came from the Planning Commission, and the ordinance that's attached reflects that. So their idea was you approve the new sign at 40 feet, no additional signs on 9th Street beyond what they have, and the pole sign that was approved for Old Navy that didn't get utilized, that be revoked. So with that, I'd be happy to address any questions about the application or the recommendation.
Mr. Andrew, a C3 is a shopping center, and what is a C5?
C5 is a service commercial district, and a C5 is a more intense district, so it has a higher sign height than a C3 district.
Okay, and a C4 is
the downtown.
Downtown commercial?
Yes.
Okay.
And so there was some discussion at the Planning Commission. All of our McDonald's stores are in C5 districts. They choose to spend the money to have 50-foot tall signs, which are permitted, but the C3, which would be like Walmart, Dillon's, places like that, the height limit is 30 feet.
So see if I get this right. We're basically going to grandfather, if we approve this, we're basically going to grandfather clause the Central Mall in, let them erect their sign, even though they are 40 feet where they should have been 30.
We believe they should have been 30 originally, but looking back at and having arrived here while that mall was under construction, and Mr. Peterson was about a week and a half in the job when he got that application, so I think he thought he was doing it correctly by saying, yes, you can have this sign, but I'm going to put a note on the permit that it has to comply with C3 sign height. That just wasn't enough communication.
And it never was.
For them. And what probably should have been done was that they should have made them submit a different plan for a 30-foot.
Because are they wanting to replace the entire sign?
Well,
or
they want to use the existing support. This would utilize the existing support. They would just tear off what's there, put this back on the existing support system.
Okay.
There.
Okay.
And
that's how I read that.
It was in the minutes, and it was partially. This will allow the reader board to set up just a little bit higher. Both of their signs got hit by semis this fall because the reader board portion was fairly low, and they're going to elevate that up. So that reader board is going to be higher on the new sign than it is right there.
And if we don't approve this, are they leaving the sign the way it is with no improvements at all?
No, they would put a new sign up, but they would have to basically take the top 10 feet off
right.
of that support and lower the sign.
Right. Okay. That answers my questions. Any other questions of Mr. Andrew?
What were the dimensions of the graphic sign in there?
The reader board reader sign board. There below is 72 square feet. I believe it's 6 by 12, 6 high and 12 wide. And then the top portion is 140 square feet.
Do you know their intended use of that reader board?
Well, Destin, if you can go to the other sign. Like many of these we're seeing, is it the reason for people moving to the electronic message center is that they can put that same information up, but they can do it from a computer inside their office as opposed to having the changeable letter. So they're going to use it for the same purpose, to announce different events and things that are going on inside the mall, but use it electronic copy instead of the changeable letters.
As a static information sign? Won't be continually updating?
I can't say that there might not be different information that they might not put up there at any one time. But we don't, just like the signs that are up presently, we don't necessarily limit their ability to change the message if they have other information they want to convey. So I don't anticipate it would be a static display.
They could have fireworks splashing around or something like that on those, and that's okay under the use right now, right?
Right.
And this is the only sign in question right now. They're not doing anything with the other one, are they?
No, they're leaving it alone. This they
it's
wanted
this
to update.
The yes. Main one, okay.
And it's a little bit complicated, but a lot of their signage that's allowed there is dictated by Penny's and Dillard's. And so even though the zoning would allow them to have more pole signs, the agreements they have with Dillard's and Penny's don't allow it. So.
Any other questions? Thank you. I'll open it up to public comment. If there is none, I will bring it back to the commission for action.
Mayor, I move we adopt on first reading ordinance number 09-10522, which amends the Central Mall PDD.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to adopt on first reading ordinance number 09-10522, application PDD 81-4K, requesting an amendment of the Central Mall to allow a pylon sign on the property addressed as 2259 South 9th Street. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed say nay. Motion passes 4-0. Administration.
Item 8.1, Bicentennial Center Business Plan. Sub-item 8.1A, Resolution Number 096669, approving the business plan. Sub-item 8.1B, Resolution Number 096670, approving the rental price schedule and annual increases in pricing description. Item 8.1C, Resolution Number 096671, approving the catering price increase and pricing description.
Mr. Perry.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. A week ago today, we presented to you the business plan, and we have made the changes. Did want to commend Ms. Seaton, Mr. Gage, Mr. Franz, for all of us, and myself. All of us had done some work on this, putting this thing together for you to get it ready for you. We had presented this to you with dealing with these various areas concerning the Bicentennial Center, and we did make the changes into the plan as outlined in the agenda report concerning economic impact, the logo, types of profitable events, and capital expense, as you will see, as well as in-house food service. We do have the three resolutions before you at this time, and we're able to answer any questions for you that you may have.
Questions of Mr. I always want to call you Mr. Marshall. Questions of Mr. Perry?
Is the $200,000 capital expense, is that what we talked about last week, is maintenance?
Yeah, maintenance and small, what we'd call small capital, depending on the needs. Again, that'll be like, and actually anything, I want to kind of emphasize, the budget projection and the plan doesn't in any way lock the governing body into really anything. It's really more of a projection type tool. So obviously that'll be subject to annual budgeting as well as all the other line items.
Okay. Thank you.
Part A, in adopting the business plan, would then adopt the plan for the food service, which could have a different outcome based on the November study. as well, it locks in and grants the ability to hire another person right now.
That's correct.
Right.
Yeah,
yes.
There's no question that once we finish a review to the rest of the year on the food service, the question of in-house versus outside contracting, it's very possible we have an amendment to the plan. It's very possible that could happen.
Any other questions?
Okay, and on coordinating the event selection and scheduling with other community venues.
Yes, sir.
Now, I've heard some talk that we haven't been as proactive as what we might be projecting. But obviously there's two sides and a couple different sides, and it probably depends on who you talk to. But I just want to ensure that we are opening those lines of communication and doing our best to communicate and make sure we coordinate.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
On the variance of pricing, you know, try to look at how we're wording that, the discretion. Essentially, where we have included the ability to reduce our proposed prices by 15%. We're taking about a 5% increase, and we could allow a 15% decrease, so we could allow a 10% lower rate than today. It talks about under competitive situations. We had talked a lot about multi-day the other day. I don't see the specific wording as only in multi-day situations here. And how do you know then if we're into competitive situations, how do you know that they're competitive either before you prepare up the proposal, or how are you informed of that after a proposal submitted that then you're in a competitive reconsideration? The basis of the question is, how do we know when we're going to toss out 15% lower and when we're not? And that's a poker game. That's a card game. How do you know when we're going to protect the profitability of the center? And not, because the way I see it, I would think about almost every event that we have there could be a competitive event. So some definition of how the eyes would look on it to know that's a competitive situation. This is one where we know that we should enter into giving some sort of a discount. How do we address those? How do we see this is a time to lower our prices and this is a time not to?
Are you asking about like consistency?
Just in general, yes. If it's a convention, odds are they're probably going to look at multiple locations. So should you do it for every convention and risk not having any? If you don't, just for our knowledge,
okay.
I would feel comforted in knowing how we are going to go about saying these are this one before we fire it out, Mr. Perry. This is an important one to go ahead and knock that 15% off now before you get it out and we don't have a chance to get it. But then equally true, how are we going to know that we didn't really just lower our rates by 10% on everything?
All right, that's a very good question, Commissioner Jennings, and I understand the direction that you're going for on this. When we're working with our larger conventions, and we work with Sylvia Rice and the wonderful people over at Visit Salina to try to be able to bring those larger groups to Salina, that would be predominantly where we'd be kind of sharpening the pencil down a little bit further to try to be sure that we're getting that business into Salina to generate it into more hotel rooms, to generate it into more shoulder events that's going on here in Salina, to where not only would they be coming to the Bicentennial Center, but we'd be able to interest those coming, the participants of the convention, to go to the other venues like Commissioner Peck was referencing, like over at the Stiefel or over at the Community Theater or the Arts Center, to try to bring all that convention business in and have more business in town for others. That's pretty much where we wind up sharpening that pencil more. Now, yes, we'll have occasional conventions call up and say, well, we're shopping you, but you know, we've got a very good roster of groups and different events who we've done over the years. Large numbers like the no-till event where we did 1,100 people in one day. That's one where we've worked with the chamber to really sharpen our pencil on that one. Pets and Sets, where they're doing anywhere from 200 to 300 a day. The NJCAA banquet, where that's 500 at a time. you know, that's the large type of events we'll be kind of sharpening our pencil on. But we will look very carefully at every event to be sure that we're not just, you know, saying, well, we like these people, we'll knock 15% off. We want to try to make the economic impact on the Bicentennial Center as well as the city of Salina very, very large.
Commissioner, just to add to that too, I think it's pretty easy for us up front just to simply inquire, are we in a competitive process or not, whether it's a renewal or whether it isn't, and to ask if there are any questions or, with regards to our rate schedule as it's published. And if there are, that will kind of give us some indication, but if there aren't, then we really have no reason to even go down the road of a discount at that point in time. So yes, hopefully we can get a good read early on.
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
Commissioner, on the first question you'd ask was related to the on the discount, the multiple days. On the resolution number 6671 in section 4, it addresses that. It deals with the 9,000 square feet. We wanted to look at the size. And then later in that same sentence, it says for multiple consecutive days or multiple consecutive years. And that language is in both of those resolutions, one for the rental pricing and the other for the meal pricing. It's in section 4. For the catering pricing and section 5 for the rental pricing. So it, yeah, we've got that in there for you.
Any other questions? Mr. Perry? Thank you. If not, I'll open it up to public comment. Seeing that there is none, I'll bring it back to the commission for action.
One of the things in looking at this, I guess I grapple with is the addition of a person. We are in some degrees returning to performance of the past, which we had more staff in place than what we have now. We're bringing kind of a new person in to help with the co-coordination, and there's a little bit of unknown in the food service area. To me, it feels like we're adding a person, or we're authorizing the addition of a person a little bit ahead of when we could really need it to get our business plan enacted and rolling. That's an authority, especially during these times, that I'm a little bit hesitant to make. I understand that it'll free up our director to do other things than promote and work with directly with the promotion activities. But not knowing definitely the outcome of the food service and exactly what our success is going to be in bolstering a few more events, I'm not completely convinced on the need of that person at this point in time. I'd like to know what some of the other commissioners think about that item, but that's probably one of the things that troubles me the most about the business plan, that we didn't get answered by the questions that we just asked.
Commissioner, just for clarification, too, if you look in the business plan and on comparative pages of page 4 and 24, those have your org charts, your current org chart, and then your proposed org chart. The thing I want to point out there is under the food and beverage division, you actually see that going backwards a full-time position. So we're actually taking away staff from that division in this recommended plan rather than adding. I think for a couple of reasons. One is we think that there's some efficiencies to be gained there, just presuming that we continue to provide food service in-house. And certainly we wouldn't add to that division if we thought that there was a chance we might not be providing food services in-house. So we're actually taking away from that in order to emphasize the marketing of the facility and the events and the promotion and co-promotion, which is what the additional position would be, the events coordinator position.
How long do you anticipate it will take to find an events coordinator?
I really don't think very long. I might want to defer that to Marshall, but I really don't think it'll take all that long.
No, ma'am, I don't think it. I'd say probably within 30 days we could have that person in place and going.
Okay.
How many, this is maybe a question I should have asked earlier. We had a breakdown of the goal for the number of events. Can you direct me to, can anybody direct me to the page of what we're shooting for as far as large events, small events, the number of events, number of meetings, the number of conventions? I was just trying to look for it, and I couldn't find it.
Page 26, maybe?
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Under, it where Ms. Seaton referenced, under the forecast objectives down on page 27, under footnote number 8, where we have additional events there, sir.
Yeah, those are just guesstimates. You know, one of the things, one of the directions that you gave us last week was particularly on the large conventions and trade shows, which are really things, there's not a lot of local competition based on the larger size events, to really, really work hard to bring all those in that we can, and that certainly is a goal.
What, just in general, with the number of things that we have recently lost, if you were to guess over the course of the next 12 months, how many more events are we shooting for out there?
Well, as we've got in the projections here, we were shooting for this first year, we're looking at assuming two large concerts each year, three conventions and trade shows, four meetings and workshop, three banquets, and two more sports events added to go ahead and try and bolster up our business at the Bicentennial Center, sir.
In addition to what we already have
now. In addition to what we're already doing now, yes, sir.
Right.
One thing that we'll try to do as well, ideally, is if we can lock those larger events in for multiple years, we're definitely going to try to do that.
One of the conventions that I have been to at other venues that I ran is where when you go to like large meeting planner conventions like RCMA, which is the Religious Convention Meeting Planners Association, when they decide on a city, they're there for 5 years, which is a very good piece of business.
What all are going to, what are going to be the responsibilities of the event coordinator? Kind of give us a feel for all of the things that position's going to do.
One of the ways that the things work at the Bicentennial Center is there's initial contact made with me regarding events and discussing events with me, and then from there on I'm able to dish some of it off or pass some of it off to members of my staff. The events coordinator position would be like their frontline person who would be handling them in addition to myself as far as what are your needs for your event, what's your timetable for your event, here's some of the other things going on in town, here's how we can assist you with your advertising, these are the better rate schedules that we can get for you, and utilizing us as an in-house advertising agency, we can receive a profit off of that, a commission off of that, which can increase the financial picture of the Bicentennial Center. It's, you know, one of the big things that people look at when they're doing conventions or events is that personal service. And that's one of the things that we want to try to be sure that we have at the Bicentennial Center is in dealing with a convention, with a meeting group. You know, they're coming from out of town. We want to have them at the Bicentennial Center really feeling like they're being taken care of and that their needs are being met. And if there's a problem or a situation comes along, we get them taken care of.
And will that person also then be the primary coordinator with Visit Salina?
Between myself and that individual.
Okay.
As well as being able to have with media contacts, with conventions, with staying in contact with these groups that contact us for information on the facility. We advertise through organizations like KCMA and meetings, publications, things of that nature, and we get shot information or requests for information mm-hmm. from them via email or via phone calls where we'd be following up with them, building up, you know, just small informational packets that we can either send out electronically or send out through the mail.
Okay.
Just one other factor too, with all the events that we do currently have, it creates a lot of hours because what happens is Marshall needs to be at every one of those events because the way we're structured today, there isn't an assistant anybody or an event coordinator. So what happens, you have the food person that's in charge of the food function and you have the operations person, which is in essence sort of doing the physical setup and layout, but none of them are really given the responsibility of dealing with all the needs of the, in essence, the coordinator on the private event side. And so when you look at all the hours of those events, it kind of, basically we add them all up. I'm not sure that we could be as aggressive to do the things that we want to do in here without having that person to do some of that. I don't think there's just enough hours for one person to do all those, to, you know, fulfill all those needs, to be as aggressive, to bring these events in and take care of them when they get here. So that's really part of the big reason for that as well.
Seems like it must be the large events. I don't have a feel for large events, but I know on small events, I'm sure we could talk to wedding planners, and some of them are going to say that some weddings takes 2 weeks, 80 hours a week to plan them, and some are going to take a few. And I imagine these things are like that. And I had added the numbers up right. We're going after a net of about 10. So we're really saying we're going to pin a salary and benefits and everything of one person on 10 more events, and then hopefully we'll have a lot more increases after that. But with Visit Salina being the marketing arm, that person's really not going to be going out to trade shows and doing all that to get the business in. We're going to rely on better customer service to turn in more customers and to renew more contracts. But I guess it's just that lower number that I'm grappling with, that we're not using it now. That's not to say that you're not completely overworked. But we're not using it now, and on 10 events, we're going to fill up a full-time person on better events coordination. That's where I hold the concern on that issue.
If
we were doing two or three more a week, it'd be really easy in my mind to say, well, we've added the kind of business that's going to keep another person busy all week long. We need to throw them in there to do that.
Yeah, truly the 10 are really the minimum objective that we have in here. Our hope is we can do more than that, but we didn't want to put 20 in and come back with, you know, 10, 12, sure, or 15 and under, not meet that expectation. Mm-hmm. But really that's a minimum goal, minimum expectation. Our hope is we can do a lot better than that.
Well, and that's why I pointed out that that's in addition to what we already have right now. Mm-hmm. And even though I don't think the Bicentennial Center has been used to its capacity, if this is your goal, and it already has things happening there,
sure,
when you total that up, Commissioner Jennings, I think his goal is fairly aggressive to what we're already having there. Some of the long time, and without being able to cite them off the top of my head, I'm sure he would, or even Ms. Rice could tell us what has been standing. First thing I think of right away is the wrestling tournament, the NJ, and
JUCO Blast.
The JUCO Blast, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
The square dancers, the dog show.
Huh?
Those are just the ones that I'm thinking of off the top of my head, because I know you see them and you see the impact. When you take these 10 on top of those that are already running, you don't think we're going to have something there about twice a month?
The thing, you know, what's really great about meeting planners is they love to share information with other meeting planners of good experiences they've had.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the things that we really want to have them share, is having a good experience at the Bicentennial Center, because they'll network among each other and tell them what a good experience they had at the Bicentennial Center, and just keep this growing.
And how did those, I find this type of work very fascinating, but how do those contracts work? If someone, what Jason just mentioned, when you attract an event here and they want to negotiate the contract for the next 2 years or the next 3 years, in the event that they are not happy with the venue, they can't get out of their contract that easily, can they?
Not really, no ma'am. What we try to do is we try to fix, you know, like let's
whatever
say
the
whatever the problem was, and we can make, you know, some type of arrangements or some type of how can we make this better. But, you know, that's where we're going to always try to keep that business happy, and that's what that events coordinator person will help do.
Well, and see, I wasn't so much thinking of that as if they're already somewhere that they're not happy,
mm-hmm,
but boy, I heard that they're really treating people good over in Salina.
Mm-hmm.
They can't get out of their contract where they are, so we have to wait till their contract runs out before they finally give us a chance.
But we'll do everything we can to try to grab all that business.
Okay.
And bring it to us.
Yeah, and keep in mind too, from a timing perspective, we used to have the director and an assistant director, and quite honestly, the role of the assistant director wasn't just locked into events type things. And so what we did is, when we had the transition of the director position, is when we eliminated that secondary position out of the budget at that point in time. Obviously, it's before we had a plan and had more aggressive goals with regards to what we want to do in that facility. So we really wanted to wait, bring on the director then, take a look and see what is going to be the approach, how aggressive aggressive do we want to be, and what do we want to do in that building? And quite honestly, so we since Marshall's been here, he's had to flag all those events himself. It really is stretching one person to do. So we've only been in that mode for probably a year, a little bit less. It's, we haven't been in there for like 5 years or anything like that. So part of it will be to try to kind of take care of what we're doing as well as to add those events.
Mm-hmm. When do we evaluate that position and look at, okay, is it a position that we need to keep around? I mean, if it's not successful in bringing in the numbers we're looking at.
One of the things that this plan does is it creates the benchmarks and indicators that we need to track as time goes on. So, for example, annually, really more than annually, but for sure annually, we'll be looking at you know, the goals in here and whether or not we're meeting those goals or exceeding those goals. So, I honestly don't take long. I don't think it'll take long to figure out if that position isn't effective. I would say of all the positions you could have for that, I think that will be the most effective if you have the right person in the position who can do their job well. And if, you know, we're in a recession right now too, so we're going to, everyone's fighting a little bit harder maybe than they would if there's a lot more money out in the economy. So we're going to have to work a little harder because of that. So you might see somewhat different performance now than you would if we weren't in this situation. But it's not going to take long to figure out the effectiveness, and it's something we'll track.
Well, not just the new position, but if we pass everything tonight, we're making some pretty major changes to the policy. So will you two be communicating throughout, you know, the upcoming months to decide if we need to make some other modifications or tweaks to the business plan to see what's working?
Right. Yeah, and in the back of the plan, there's a lot of systems that will be put in place to help us track all the data we need that we really can't track as well as we'd like to today. And so that's definitely something we'll pay close attention to.
Yeah, and I think I don't want to leave anything up in the air by the numbers that we used, which are conservative. They're low. We hope for upside surprise. You've shown where we are, and this is leaving in the maintenance capital, the $200,000. We're going to improve the cost to taxpayers by $70,000 from 2008 to 2013. Without the $200,000 in there, then we're moving a $270,000 difference in the way that the facility fills right now.
Right.
And that's a substantial improvement, especially when we're feeling, according to the Wichita State study, $10.2 million worth of impact to Salina a year. We don't want to lose that, and I think that's the key why we're doing things. It's on that position, I'm just concerned about the timing. I guess what I don't, you know, I would not like to hear is 4 months down the road, well, or a half a year, we really hired the wrong person, and now we kind of got to deal with that. But what we really need is somebody that's going to be an on-the-road marketer, or, you know, these kind of things. The business plan is deep, and I know that it's taken a while, but are we sure that, you know, this is the time we need to grab that person, we need to etch them in stone, we need to say this is where we're heading. And what we're going to do.
I think so. You know, historically, prior to the assistant manager position, when we had someone else in a position that didn't carry that title, but they were really kind of informally an events coordinator, and that's back when you saw some of your statistics were higher on the events. And so I think at that time it showed that it did work better even then. So I think, without question, you're going to be able to see that impact. And if we don't hire the right person and we have a probationary period, we switch out. We need to have someone who can do that job. But I think the idea of going, if we were just looking at the rental of the facility approach still, and waiting for people to come or events to come to us, there's no really probably not much of a reason we'd need that position except just maybe to help cover hours. But quite honestly, when we go into a really more aggressive promotion or co-promotion approach, and we're actually going to go out, build relationships and try to bring those promoters and booking agents to us, I think without question we'll be able to use that time pretty wisely, and I think you'll see some good results out of it. I think if we have a problem, it'll be finding the right dates where we're not on top of ourselves or on top of someone else and trying to make sure we balance that. I think that might be our challenge.
Who would be the community? This is back to Commissioner Peck's question on the coordination between the venues in town. Who is that point person going to be that would lock arms with the community theater and the Stiefel and sit down with calendars and plan things out and really do what we've been saying? Would that be the events coordinator? Would it be Mr. Perry? Would it be Who would that be?
Today it's Marshall. It kind of be up to him, but I suspect if you get a good events a person in there and they're doing a really good job, have those relationships built, he'd probably feel comfortable allowing them to do a lot of that, if not all of it. Mm-hmm. So it really could be either one at that point in time.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The only other thing that I'd like to talk a little bit more about is the $200,000 that we have in for maintenance capital. I'd kind of like to get a little bit more input and more feeling. We've talked about sound system, maybe tables, maybe some more work on the floor. It kind of sounds like a lot of the things that we already have, if you take a look at different departments within the city, they too budget for new computers and new office equipment and new vehicles and or a replacement snow plow or whatever. Aren't these the kind of things that we're talking about within an annual budget? And so then why are we calling it out separate? Are we trying to approve money above and beyond for future approval of the budget and make sure that we understand that we're going to do it? It just seems a little bit odd. I understand the desire to put it out there for the need, but it just seems like that should be an ongoing part of the annual budget submittal by the Bicentennial Center to the city, to the commission.
Yeah, that's exactly how it would work in practice. I think the reason for calling it out in the plan is first to acknowledge that we haven't budgeted general maintenance well at all for the Bicentennial Center. And because of that, if we say, well, we need to do that, and we assume we may have some small capital items or things like tables and chairs that add up to hundreds of thousands of dollars, rather than say, hey, look, we're going to save you $270,000 or $80,000 to the general fund and then turn around and surprise you later and say, well, but there's a couple hundred thousand we need for these things and give you that surprise later of a net. We wanted to be really upfront to say whether 200 is the number or not, it's a pretty good number that we need to properly maintain and replace those items. So let's show it in the plan upfront and be upfront with you today just so you know that. So you know if the net is 80,000 or whatever, wherever it ends up, that you expected that from the beginning and we didn't surprise you later and say, hey, we'll save you all this money, but we're going to throw in an extra cost. So the real point of that is just to really state to say that we need to do a better job of maintenance and have some small capital in there. That's really it.
It's really just communicating the breakout of expenses of maintenance as one of the expenses, where now what little's done just kind of falls into the general expenses.
That's exactly right.
Okay. Thank you.
Anything else? Did I already open it up to public comment? I can't remember. Did I?
Yeah.
Okay. Then I will bring it back to the commission for action. And I will need three separate motions.
Mayor, I move we adopt resolution number 09-6669, approving the Bicentennial Center's business plan.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to adopt resolution number 09-6669, approving the business plan for the Bicentennial Center. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All those opposed say nay. Motion passes 4-0.
Mayor, I'd move we adopt resolution number 09-6670, approving the rental price schedule, annual increases, and pricing discretion.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to adopt resolution number 09-6670, approving the rental price schedule, annual increases, and pricing discretion. All those in favor say aye.
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 All those opposed say nay. Motion passes 4-0.
Mayor, I'd also move we adopt resolution number 09-6671, approving the catering price increase and pricing discretion.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to adopt resolution number 09-6671, approving the catering price increase and pricing discretion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed say nay. Motion passes 4-0.
Item 8.2, resolution number 096672, amending the city's purchasing policy pertaining to the promotion and co-promotion of events at the Bicentennial Center.
Okay.
Mr. Perry? Okay.
Yes, commissioners, this is the resolution amending the city's purchasing policy for allowing the Bicentennial Center for promotion and co-promotion of events. As we addressed in the business plan we discussed with y'all last week. What we're trying to do is to be able to handle contractual and financial logistics of promotion and co-promotion. We need to do a change to the city's basic purchasing policy. The current policy, as you know, limits purchases to $10,000. What we are seeking to do is expand this out further as the resolution that you have that would, I'm sorry, I took my glasses off and I can't read without them and I'm squinting. I apologize. Would extend this out to where we will be able to actually buy and purchase our own shows at the Bicentennial Center.
Mr. Gage, did you wish to add anything to this?
Well, I just to kind of complement that, too, we talked before about getting the right event, making sure it's in the right venue, on the right date, and at the right price point. That's very strongly emphasized in this, and it also, I want to emphasize it as it relates to working with our agencies locally in Salina. That's what we have to do, so we're going to work very hard to do that. And, you know, we talked about with promoting and co-promoting, there's some big advantages you can get from that. You can make more money for your event, which eventually would offset the cost of operating the Bicentennial Center, but you have to make good decisions, or because there are risks also in that, and the business plan does address dealing with those risks, and it's part of what I just mentioned. But we want to be diversified in the types of events, and we want to research the events. And there's information out there, so you can do that to try to find an event that you think works for your demographic and your type of facility. So we want to do that, find the right partners, and we want to have good contractual terms. We don't want to have a deposit obligation to where the other side can just decide not to participate and we lose a deposit. We don't want to make decisions like that. The other thing is, when you look at this, it does provide for the staff to have authority to enter in promotion and co-promotion for these types of events with a maximum per event at $100,000. One of the key things to this is it requires a pre-event assessment of risk and related factors. That's a real key formally. We need to do that with every event. But the other part is it requires a post-event assessment because we want to have a comparable analysis. We want to see what did we estimate or project and what did it end up being. And if it's significantly different, why is that and what can we learn from that event for the future and for other events? So we put that in there because we thought that it made sense to integrate that as part of how we deal with events. And then it obviously deals with how we're going to handle the funds, making sure that there's a proper budgetary means to do that so that we can segregate and we know how we perform at year end, and also make sure that this is included in the financial audit. That's really redundant, but we wanted to have that in the policy just to make sure.
Questions of Mr. Perry or Mr. Gage?
Mr. Perry, since you're head of the Bicentennial Center, I assume that final decisions at your feet on whether you hire a band or hire someone to come in under a co-promotion or promotion, but who all will you be conferring with to make the determination up to that point whether this is the right, whether they hit the right demographic, whether the price is right, all of those factors? Right.
There are numerous publications out there that are available to me, such as Polestar, which is just one very small example. They track and chart the ticket sales of a tour all the way through up until that current date when they release it. I also have online availability of being able to track and chart how ticket sales are doing with other venues. Ticketing systems that I have contacts with will tell me how a show is doing as it is en route before we ever sign a contract on something, as well as being able to know what that artist has that is going to be in the pipeline, so to speak. Like, are they going to have a new release? Are they going to be doing something that will really put them out there to where they're going to be a big draw ticket sale wise? That'll be some of the methods that we evaluate this. Not only that, we would talk to the various radio stations and media in this market to be able to determine what is their largest market share. What are they doing best with? Like, what radio station is doing the best? What are they seeing as being what people are listening to? Say, for example, here in Salina, classic rock is the top radio grabber on Nielsen charts here in this area. That might be an audience or a type of artist that we would look at to try to target that audience. If country is bigger, we would look at that. If it would be, say, old school rock and roll, something of that nature, old school funk jams, something of that nature. There's all kinds of ways to track this. I have contacts and friends who are in the music industry and in the entertainment industry who I can talk to, and I can have somebody say, oh yeah, band A, is that's who you really want to have come. And I can call three other friends and they'll all go, man, band A tanked in Nevada and in Montana and in Ohio. So you have to really do your research on anything, and that's part of what I have the ability to do.
How do you plug in the specific demographics of Salina in our area, our age demographic, our median income, our all of those types of things?
Well, what you need to look at also is, you know, what someone is willing to pay for a ticket. And that's one of the reasons we were very excited on Bob Dylan. Bob Dylan, we thought, was a fantastic ticket price. And the results showed that, because we had people who traveled a long way who came to see the show, Wichita, Topeka, Lawrence, Manhattan, Minneapolis. We had a lot of people come from all over, not just the Salina area, who traveled for that show. Now, granted, he was the only Kansas stop. Salina was the only stop for that tour. But what you look at is what the market will bear. You know, when you're, as we discussed a week ago, if it takes 80% of the Bicentennial Center to sell, to clear cost on the show, that's not a good show. We want to look at right around a 50 to 60% of sales of tickets to cover the cost of the show. Then from that point is profit beyond that.
Okay.
Would you have, if it were up to you?
Commissioner Pickett, I'm sorry, I'm having difficulty hearing you. I apologize.
No, not a problem. If it were up to you, now you and I have already talked that the date conflicted with the Bob Dylan show,
right?
With football games, et cetera. But if it were up to you, would you have brought in that Bob Dylan show?
Would I personally, like at the Bicentennial Center, had we bought that show?
As a business decision to actually promote?
Probably not.
Okay.
Not at that particular time, because there was too much going on, I think, football-wise. There's too much going on other concert-wise in Kansas City and elsewhere that I think impacted that show. If the Bicentennial Center had had the opportunity to buy that show, I would probably have said, no, we're not looking at I would not be as amenable to doing that show.
And that would have, if ticket sales had been as they were, we would have lost money on that show.
I don't believe so, sir. What I was told by the production company that did the show come the end of the night, I talked to them frequently all during the day, and they said, you know, we cleared money, we're okay.
Okay, now if I heard those numbers right, only about a sixth of the tickets, maybe a fifth of the tickets sold?
We had a little over 2,000, including comps in the building, yes, sir.
Okay, and we were talking about 50% of tickets needing to sell to
That's
actually...
Correct. Now, they had the entire tour, so they may just be amateurizing it out.
Okay.
But they said, because, you know, they had this company that brought Bob Dylan here, they were the one that had the entire tour. So they probably were just amateurizing their dates out.
Okay.
That's a pretty good example of, do you use the worst case to make the decision to promote or co-promote, or do you want to have some buffer in there? And when we talk about wanting to fill at least half the seats, we want to put some buffer in there and not rely on what maybe would be the worst case.
And I have a question that it might go to our city clerk, because she might have more experience on this than... Yeah, she looked up. Sorry to put you on the spot. We have so many commissions and advisory boards and, you know, from everything from Parks and Rec to the library. We have never had anything like that for the Bicentennial Center, have we?
Not that I can recall.
Any kind of a commission or advisory board or anything? I thought of that when Commissioner Angel asked who actually will be determining what happens and what you're aggressively seeking. And so there is no advisory. There never has been anything at the Bicentennial Center regarding conventions or groups or events or anything like that.
Never purchased.
I'm not aware. And one reason may be simply because if you're looking for certain expertise in there, you may find that you run into conflicts of people that may, for example, say it's the local media that may actually work with co-promoting with regards to advertising and marketing. So that may be why, or, you know, it's possible it was just never thought of as something to do. It's hard to tell.
Just curious. Mm-hmm.
I have worked in other venues where we had, like, people that would come and they would advise on that. And some of the suggestions, it's very personally based as opposed to financially based. And what I'm more looking at is financially and profitability based as opposed to, yeah, I really like such and such, so I want to see him on stage, and that's one ticket, whereas I want to sell a lot of tickets.
But you would be surprised how many people sit on those boards those advisory commissions, and it's personal to them, too.
Yep.
How would our city manager and feel about utilizing these pre-assessments And until there was enough comfort, there'd be at least the two, if not more, reviewing these in order to form the comfort saying, okay, the formula that you described, the various publications and different people that you can talk to,
right,
that's given us enough assurance that we're fine. Because, $100,000 is a lot of leniency. You make one wrong assumption, and that's going to be difficult. The weight of that on your shoulders should make you play conservative, but then also that might not be the right approach to gathering the entertainment that we want. So I see that an awful huge amount for one person, and can we form that?
Sure, absolutely. That's actually in discussing how we're going to administer this in the first place. That's really the natural approach that we talked about anyway. Marshall's really good about communicating and kind of talking through the advantages, disadvantages, issues, whatever it might be. So that relationship works well anyhow. I don't see any problem with that. We, you know, quite honestly, in the first year we do this, we want to be successful. And what we estimated is we said we would like to be successful in three out of four. If we do four, let's say, concerts, we want to be successful three out of four, and we want to be able to minimize a risk such that the fourth one, or whether it's the first one or the fourth one, whichever, but the one out of four that we're not successful, that it's not a huge loss, that when we add up the three wins, that we're still to equal or to the positive. And that's the key of where we want to be. So that's kind of how we would expect to do that in the first place. So, yeah, that makes sense.
How quickly can you move to that pre-assessment form? What's the plan? Is it right away after today?
It would be before we promote an event.
Okay. that's a great answer.
Good to know.
I'm talking like a city manager, I guess.
Yeah, that's a great answer.
Any other questions of either Mr. Gage or Mr. Perry? Mr. Marshall. Thank you. If not, I'll open it up to public comment. Seeing that there is none, I'll bring it back to the Commission for action.
Mayor, I move we adopt resolution number 09-6672, which amends the city's purchasing policy by establishing section 6.5, setting forth policy and procedures regulating the promotion and co-promotion of events at the Bicentennial Center.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to approve resolution number 09-6672, amending the city's purchasing policy pertaining to promotion and co-promotion of events at the Bicentennial Center. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed say nay. Motion passes 4-0.
Item 8.3, approved change order number 2 for the Bicentennial Center renovation improvements, phase 2, project number 092772.
Excuse me if I ask, how long have you been here now with us?
Today.
I meant
I'm sorry,
with
shouldn't.
The city of Salina. This is the most we've seen of you. Has it been a year?
No, ma'am. My first official day was December 1.
Almost a year. Mm-hmm. It's nice to see you.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Perry, again.
I've totally messed my mind up here.
Sorry.
Great. Okay. All right. No, I'm sorry. I've left it over on the chair. Excuse me. Sorry, I was enjoying my time with y'all. I forgot to get the rest of my paperwork. Ladies and gentlemen, actually, I'm going to ask Mr. Hall to go ahead and bring up for y'all just a couple of slides here regarding how the renovations have been going at the Bicentennial Center. Now, that is how the meeting rooms used to look. Go ahead. That is how they look now. As you can see, they've done we have representatives here from Jones Gillum Renz. We've got who've done what I think is a very commendable job on trying to bring all this together. You can see in there the acoustical panels that are down along the bottom of the wall. I know y'all got an incredibly fast tour a few weeks ago when you were in there with all these trades and hammers and sawing going on around you. You've got the large boards that are on the walls, the sconces, the new color scheme, the new carpet down, the cloud ceiling with the LCD projectors in there. Let's go to the next slide. This is what a meeting room used to look like.
and here's what it looks like today. That is the setup that is going on in there right now for the Kansas Pipeline event that is going to be at the Bicentennial Center for the next few days, where we're doing lots of meals and events setting up, and they were very excited to have all this done for them for upstairs. It's really, I don't know if you can really see it, there's a little motion sensor that's up there in the ceiling right next to the LCD projector that's on the right-hand side. We've designed these rooms to where if by perchance the rooms get unoccupied for too long of a period of time, all the lights go out. We've tried to make everything as energy efficient as we could. Same thing for in the restrooms. Same thing for the corridors up on the second floor. We want to try to make sure that the place is a savings as far as energy, nice for people to come and hold their meetings and et cetera, and make it just a really nice overall presentation at the Bicentennial Center for our clients. We have the construction change order that is before you today. What we are asking for your consideration is originally the project had finishing out Heritage Hall, and what we are asking for today is finishing Heritage Hall. We looked at that very small timeline that we had. With all the events that we've had, we've been able to move people around. We're asking for you to approve us going on ahead and doing this phase two to complete out Heritage Hall. You've got in the report where it's fixing the mechanical aspects of the room, meaning heating and air conditioning controls and et cetera, to make sure, which will be 50% more efficient than current systems. The system should have a 5-year payback on it, meaning the savings over 5 years should pay for the system. The electrical, which is upgrading new and improved lighting and sound and energy efficient equipment, which will enhance the facility as far as saleability. Demolition, the finishes, moisture protection, fixing a few problems that are with the flooring, doors, and et cetera. This is all part of the 2009-2013 capital improvement program. I brought this before you today asking that we could go ahead and approve this at this time. I'm asked, and if you have any questions, I'll be glad to answer them. Or Mr. Jeff Gillum is here from Jones Gillum Rents, if you have any questions of him as well.
Questions of Mr. Perry?
How do you, I'm not sure how to word this. It seems like a project that almost is $1 million.
Yes, sir.
Is a pretty tough change order just to say, yep, let's go with it and not put this out to bid. And I understand, that we can do that. I think the wording is generally open enough that it could be done. I just, from a competitive open standpoint, I have a little bit of a issue with that, and I have, speaks nothing to their work at all.
You bet. Aaron, Jeff Gillum with Jones Gillum Rents. I'm glad you asked that question, really, because a couple points that I'd like to point out is, you know, we contacted probably 8 general contractors for the original phase. We only got 3 bids, one of which was here locally and one of which qualified their bid that they could not meet the schedule. So that's some of the consideration we wanted to look at. We've got a contractor now. The other second part of that is he is currently working in Heritage Hall, and as we continue on to work on the HVAC and some of the things Marshall listed, there's some overlapping of labor and material that we can make this more efficient. We feel that's reflected in the numbers. Our concern is if we bid it at this time, a year later, I think because of the schedules and the venues that are going, going on, is that it actually will cost us more. Now, again, that's a guess, that's a projection, but that's one of the reasons we really felt we wanted to bring that before you as a consideration. So those 2 points, how well our bids were received, because again, even if we postpone it and bid it later, the Bicentennial Center will still have a lot of venues, and as you may or may not know, I mean, they're starting, they're stopping. When every time they stop, they've got to clean up, get ready for another venue. A lot of contractors don't want to deal with that, and that's some of the issue we're dealing with. It's not a very good marketable construction job.
So this was thrown out to 8 different contractors?
I have a question.
We contacted 8 original general contractors.
Originally, yeah.
How long ago was that? When you say you contacted them?
July.
Right before the bidding.
Okay.
We send out invitations to bid. We contact all the locals. You know, we want to try and take care of them.
But at the time, was it only for phase one? When you...
For phase one, yes, that's
correct.
Correct,
okay.
Yeah,
and the timeline you say was pretty tight on that, because I realize they wanted it done in a matter of, has it been a month, 6 weeks?
4 weeks and 5 days.
Okay. But since July, I had issues with that also, simply because just awarding the bid to them because they're already on site and we're happy with their work and et cetera, et cetera. The only thing is, I feel that the economy has changed a little bit since July, and I wondered if you would have known this even 3 or 4 weeks ago, that they could have bid on this to start right now, if you would have had anybody that could have met that timeline to do that work now.
Yeah, a little more complicated than that. We knew that work was going to come. It was really an issue of the equipment availability and getting all those systems engineered in a time frame that they could start that.
Mm-hmm.
So we were playing a little bit of catch up. We knew we could put out phase one because the drawings and engineering, everything was done, but this part of it still had a lot. I mean, you're talking about a much bigger space,
mm-hmm,
than the meeting room upstairs, you know, 38,000 square feet. So,
mm-hmm,
it's a much bigger space, a lot more technical issues, you know, lighting, acoustics. And so we were catching up, and we weren't ready to bid that at that time. So we knew that was going to have to come at a later date.
Well, let me say, I think what's been done looks fabulous, and I can understand why you're anxious to get everything done and have it complete, but I'm with the mayor and Commissioner Peck. We're looking at almost $1 million contract, and that makes me really uneasy that we're not going to get competitive bids on that.
Any other questions?
The general that we have out there right now,
yes,
out of this work, majority of it is mechanical, electrical.
That's correct, yes, sir.
Are they utilizing subcontractors to do work now? Are they mechanical and electrical subcontractors? And the third part of the question, I keep looking your way, and I'm sorry,
you
might know. And then the third part of the question is, are those mechanical contractors and electrical contractors, subs, that are on site, Salina-based?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Could you, who are they using for those right now?
For mechanical, it's Pestinger.
Okay.
For electrical, it's Precision.
Mm-hmm. Plumbing,
Fraser Brothers.
Those are
flooring.
The three big subcontractors. Yeah. Ritter Tile is doing all the flooring, carpet.
And in essence, this project would be, you said like 30% mechanical, 25% electrical. The finishes are 20%.
Uh-huh. Right here.
There's no guarantee that they would continue that relationship with those subs because...
it would be the same team.
Okay.
The bids and the quotes that have been put together for the change order would be all the same contractors that are currently on site.
That's a good point.
And that's the overlap that we're hoping to achieve, is because as Ritter's in there doing some flooring, he's continuing on. As Pestinger's in there doing the mechanical, he's continuing on. So the workforce is there, equipment's there. So we're saving setup, takedown, restart, all those kind of things.
Yeah, if you carry it forward, it would be, I mean, odds are it would be very difficult at this point in time for them to look at other subcontractors, trade one mechanical company for another, because they're already mobilized. They're already got their supervisor on site. However, that doesn't necessarily say that it's a wise purchasing decision, because there might be another company that's hungrier. So it doesn't necessarily void, I don't think, the concern of Commissioner Peck, but it is Salina-based work. So even though Salina general contractors could not perform the work, we still have a great majority of the work actually being completed,
yeah,
by Salina-based subcontractors.
Commissioners, one thing we could do as well, on the assumption that the current subs wish to continue, which we definitely believe they do, given the current building climate, we could require as a condition of this with the general that they continue to utilize those subs so that we ensure that we have those Salina businesses working. Yeah, part of the issue is that we have, as Marshall mentioned, really, this is really, we call it Phase 1 and 2. It's really Project Phase 1A and B because they're really related. And what will happen is if we can't get to it until next summer, which will be the earliest we can because the late winter and spring are our busiest times at the Bicentennial Center, so we would have to wait that long. You might see prices rise. We don't know for sure. We're just presuming that they're not probably going to go lower. We don't know that for sure. But the situation you're going to have is you're going to have a Heritage Hall that has a floor that's finished and walls that are finished, but a ceiling that's not been won't be touched, and you won't have the sound system, lighting, and some of the other upgrades. So, but from an aesthetic perspective, you're going to go in, and when you look straight out, it's going to look pretty nice, and you're going to look up, and you're going to wonder, why in the world didn't we finish the project? So we kind of looked at it as a continuation of the current project, recognizing it is a big part of it because of all the mechanical and electrical that needs to be done. That's why it's more expensive in the square footage that we have in that space. But it really is part of the same project that had to be divided up just simply based on our ability to prepare and get the project moving.
And I understand that, but we, by doing an A and a B, we did say that was going to be acceptable because we just peeled out A and said, we've got a narrow slot, let's get A done. Now we're seeing that we've got another narrow slot following the original narrow slot where we could get B done.
And that was
Phase 1, Phase 2. So I understand, and I don't want somebody coming in from out of state saying, well, it looks like Salina ran out of money on the ceiling. We definitely don't want that. But we did put ourselves in the position of saying that's exactly what we're going to do. That's how we started the project. We did say Phase 1. We did say Phase 2. So while I agree with it, I don't think that should be the prevailing concern. On the subcontractor issue, definitely I think that if you continued that, you might continue with some Salina subcontractors. It's probably naive to think that there's not going to be a pretty big voice out by other people that would have liked to bid on a much larger mechanical scale, as is on this phase, or a much larger electrical scale compared to the Phase 1, and would say this really just doesn't seem like a proper situation, which goes back to the issuing it as a change order prevents the competitive bids. And
that was my question. That was my concern, that if it was running on schedule, why 3 weeks ago or 4 weeks ago did they not take bids for Phase 2, knowing that they were going to be this close to completion at the end of October? Why they didn't take bids for Phase 2 to start in right where Phase 1 was ending? And the reason that's why I mentioned, back in July, the companies that said they couldn't do it were in a different economic mode, and it is, if you want to call it slower season or off season or winter season or whatever. So were there not any companies that could have, a month ago, bid on Phase 2 to start right where Phase 1 had ended, using the subcontractors that are there now to keep that seamless but yet be able to competitively bid, and we don't know where they would have come in on this bid?
No, and there's no way you could guarantee that a different general is going to use the same subcontractors. Part of it is I think there's no question this is a big change order. There's no question about that. And I would agree that the timeline in and of itself may not be the prevailing issue. But I think, at that time, I'm not sure things have changed that much, really. Things were very bad then, and things are still very bad for the building industry. People are hungry. We've heard that a lot. But we did go out to try to determine if there's interest of 8 local general contractors and received one, and that was conditioned, and it wasn't even close to meeting the timeline. Now, the other thing that we ran into with this, and this is just more of a contractor's performance issue, but they ran into a couple things that had nothing to do with this project but needed to be addressed as part of it as change orders. And initially, they said that these will take X number of days. And I asked Marshall, I said, what happens if you're one day past your substantial completion date? He said, we're into an event. And I said, well, we can't do that. So he went back and talked with them. They said, we'll get it done within this timeline. So they did work very, very hard to meet all the goals of this. So they've done a good job. And I think part of this is probably our confidence level in the work that they've actually done, the timeline, staying within cost, and so forth. But it's really just the policy question is for you as a commission is, definitely the bid issue. How important is it to bid, to open up a bid, particularly if there wasn't a lot of interest just a few weeks ago? Doesn't mean there won't be. There could be today. the timing of the project and how long you want to wait, both from the perspective of simply finishing this part and also from the perspective of just, you know, will the price go up or will it not? And we don't know that. We simply don't have an answer for you with regards to that. It could, might not. We really don't know. And so that's sort of an unknown, and that's kind of where we are. And we, I mean, we can make it work either way, quite honestly.
I guess what Commissioner Jennings was getting at is, I guess there are other local electrical subs and local mechanical subs that might want the opportunity to be involved in phase two that wouldn't have the opportunity if we don't put it out to bid. And the question I have, is there some reason to believe that Cheney, if we put it out to bid, is there some reason to believe Cheney won't bid on phase two?
No, I would expect them to bid on phase two.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
The Heritage Hall floors, are those finished now?
The prep work has been done on them, yes, sir, getting ready to do that. What we're looking at, though, is putting down a new flooring. If you were to approve this, we wouldn't want to put down the new floor and then demo ceilings above it. What we're looking at doing is going ahead, demo the ceilings, then doing the flooring. Mm-hmm. It just balances out much nicer that way.
Yeah, that's probably one of the little concerns that's out there. I know there's going to be ways to protect it, but you're going to have lifts run around all over the place over a finished floor. You've got finished walls out there. It's just kind of a, I know the project is what it is right now, but I don't think there's very many people that would rip out the ceiling and do all the overhead work last and jeopardize all the wall finishes and floor finishes. The walls are done. Is that correct?
They're in process.
Okay.
They were on site today getting some of the stuff prepared to go up on the wall, so yes, sir.
So functionally, the only difference in the project would be we would not finish the floor. We would go right into that phase two. We would do all the overhead work and then finish the floor. Whereas when we approved phase one, we said we're going to do the nice floor but still do the overhead work down the road. So we already had a plan to address that. The work that we were going to have to do overhead after phase one was done. So unless I'm wrong on that, that's not really a prevailing concern. It's going to be more difficult. You're going to have a finished floor on a project to work over the top of if we go out for bid, but we already had planned on doing that mm-hmm. in the nature of doing it phase one, phase two.
Exactly. Any other questions of Mr. Perry?
Well, I had some real reservations about this in the amount. But if I'd like to make sure everything is open and we have solid bidding processes for contractors. And looking at this from a business decision, however, we are supplying several other contractors, local contractors, with work as well. For continuity purposes, it makes a lot of sense to award this. And especially considering only 3 months ago, we had very little interest at all in phase one of the project. That's a little bit telling to me. I don't know. Maybe in phase two we would have a whole lot more, but I don't know. This is a little bit difficult, I suppose.
Commissioner Peck, I guess I kind of grapple with that same thing, but we did prepare up and put out a very short bid. We're going to drastically narrow the field of contractors that can jump right out of the dugout and get right on a project. And the subs are only as good as, or the contractors are only as good as the subs behind them, and we're seeing great work, and that's a lot of the subs. But we did narrow our field with a very tight timeline. And one of the benefits, I would think, with an engineered package that is biddable now, and unfortunately a time frame that wouldn't be until a ways down the road, is you should open it up to a lot more contractors. I venture to guess the ones that we had that could jump on it from a general basis were already filled with their bigger projects, which is a good sign, because that means they're good contractors. But I don't necessarily agree that we just would have the same narrow field unless we said, let's put it out on a two-day bid process so we can start next Monday. Then I think we would still get a pretty narrow field of people that would have man crew large enough to jump in and perform the work in a short order of time. In other words, I wouldn't expect to get a different result doing the same thing that we did on phase one. If we don't proceed with it, then I would expect to get a completely different result.
Well, there's no guarantee that these subcontractors are available to continue on to phase two as is there?
Yes, this the bid that you have before you is the current team.
And you said that. So those subcontractors have been contacted, and they can stay on the job and work seamlessly
through
phase two.
They've provided their bids to the general contractor, and they've committed to the schedule. One just clarification that I'd like to offer is, I know Norm's talking about if we put this out, you're still going to be fighting the same challenge of Marshall's going to have a window here, hurry up, get some stuff done, and a window here. It's not just the fact that hurry up and do it, it's the fact that you're starting, stopping, because we have got to shut down work Friday, clean everything up, allow him to bring a venue in, set up, conduct the venue, then the contractor can start the following week or the next 3 days. So that's going to always exist. It's those small blocks of time to mm-hmm. try and work around the venue, because we don't want to lose revenue. We want Marshall to continue to keep the place full.
Mm-hmm.
So
I agree with that. What I was alluding to was, what was the amount of time between when the bid was the bid packet was presented and the time when we had that window to jump in? Seemed like that was a pretty short
window.
Yes,
it was.
Very
aggressive.
And that's what I'm saying, probably ruled out a fair amount of general contractors. I'll just pick a different word. Ruled out a lot of general contractors, because that was the stop-start and all the
timeline.
Nightmares that you're saying. But do those nightmares starting next week or starting in a very short amount of time, and that's when the contractors are going to look and say, well, where are my superintendents? And there's just no way that I can get things moved around in that short amount of time to jump on that project. I especially say that because I don't necessarily want to paint a picture of disinterest on the part of Salina's general contractors on the project without some defendable reasons that they might have been busy on schools and on other projects and just didn't have the ability to mobilize and jump on the project and give it the attention that it needed.
Yeah, Commissioner, I think that's probably true. One thing that we may have to deal with if July is going to be our open date is that at that point, if you're a contractor, you'd prefer to do a lot of your outside work. Winter is the best time to do your inside work, so we're going to kind of flip-flop that season. Whether it has an impact, it's hard to tell. It may or may not.
Yeah, and unfortunately, or however you want to say that, unfortunately, we're getting ready for the winter season when most contractors are hungry to get inside work like this. And we don't have another opportunity during the winter. If we could have saw that we were going to have this extended opportunity,
that's,
we could have probably put a package
exactly
out that was
right.
Real enticing, because it was going to be an inside project through the winter. But we're not going to have that unless, God forbid, unless we lose some events or something like that, and then a window opens up that we can get through then.
My concern is I don't want to lose our credibility on our bidding process. That's where I'm coming from. Any public comment?
Commissioner Sylvia Rice with Visit Salina. Obviously, a lot of things to consider, and I'm going to do what I generally do, which is step into the shoes of the client, and encourage you to consider the change order in that viewpoint. The city manager is exactly right. When you walk into Heritage Hall, if we could have that package finished when some of our largest, in my estimation, most important clientele, our annual events, start to arrive through the winter and spring, obviously for those of us across the street, that would be phenomenal. It is, you know, the process of starting to tell the story has already begun with meeting planners across the state about what's coming. what's coming. And so if the ability is there to have that package finished when we begin to parade the meeting planners through, rather than use your imagination, this is going to look very much like upstairs. That's what I would just kind of put out there for you to consider. It could be very important to us. Again, we've got some big events coming in January through April, through May for that matter. That would be my thoughts.
Yeah, we're wanting to.
Thank you.
This is really actually difficult. I agree with Commissioner Jennings' logic on this, I guess, Sylvia makes a good point. If I'm a restaurant business trying to attract, working hard to come up with a business plan and trying to attract new business, and I am a fine dining establishment and have all of my linen and china set out with my folding metal chairs, that could dampen my outlook going forward in getting those clients back. And I don't necessarily mean that's going to happen with the buy center, but we're out here encouraging a business plan, encouraging our staff to make sure that the buy center attracts more business and keeps these big conventions and banquets, etc. And while I understand we probably could have done something differently on phase two in the bidding process, I think we ought to look towards completion and making sure that we present the best facility we have out there, so that going forward we don't have to subsidize like we've had to in the past.
But if my restaurant has excellent food, they're not going to care what my chairs look like. They're going to come to my eating establishment because of the reputation, because of the service.
I've already figured that in. I eat there every Monday.
Okay.
Just joking.
Commissioners, for clarification, though, I do want to make sure on the timeline we clarify. We did not choose not to have the design for phase two finished and then come back and say, now we need to rush it and do a change order. The progression of the design was what it was based on the timeline of when we got the initial go-ahead. So we just really, the design aspect was not ready at the time that we started with the phase one to say, we're going to have a phase two. We know what the scope is. Give us a bid. Or if you're the successful bidder, we know it's going to be $900,000. We just simply weren't far enough along at that time. So we are there now, and that's kind of what forced it. We kind of, because of the aggressive timeline from the very beginning, with design and construction, it forced us into, if we want to get this part of the project done this winter, really the change order was the only approach we had. So it was really the choice of, do you want to do it this winter or do you want to do it next summer?
Yeah.
It wasn't by choice to wait.
I think, Commissioner Peck, you're completely right. But unfortunately, when we've taken the tours around, we're going to have to convince them to not look at the exterior. We're going to have to convince them to not look at the atrium, because we've said we don't like the aged look of the atrium. We're going to have to tell them to look past a whole lot of things before we tell them to look past the ceiling. And I have all the confidence in the world, because we have been convincing our customers to look past those, that if the right decision is to postpone it, we're going to convince them to look past the ceiling, if that's the right decision. I keep wrestling with I'm done wrestling, but I keep feeling the same thing. If we were blowing down Crawford and we hit a new street that the engineering wasn't done and we didn't have a bid packet out and it was all of a sudden done and we hadn't pulled our contractor off and we said we can just give them a change order to blow down the other 10 blocks now that they're engineered, I think we probably wouldn't do that. We would probably say, let's put it out for bid. So, that's what I wrestled with in the beginning. That's very much a similar analogy, in my opinion. You've got one project that's completed, and you can continue right on with the other one with that same contractor and crew, or you can say that's a separate project. That's the way that it came through in engineering or whatever, and go with it. I understand that originally we said this was one project. I got confused because I heard about Project 1 and Project 2, and we were talking about the atrium and in the arena and out in the exterior, and I didn't know what was Project 1 and 2, but if this was to have been together and we had to peel it apart, then we kind of separated it into two projects.
Is the wrestling tournament over? Are we done grappling? Any more comments or questions?
No.
I have no problem with change orders. I would have no problem if this was a $200,000-$300,000 change order. Again, I just am worried about our credibility with our bidding process. That's my basis for not feeling comfortable with this. With that, I will bring it to the commission for action. Going once. If there is no action, it dies for lack of action. Is that correct?
That is true, Mayor.
And we're certain as we can be today, that July of next year or July-ish is the earliest we would be able to entertain this.
Yes, sir. The way the calendar currently is now, the only window of time that we have is next July.
One final other pertinent question that I'm sorry I didn't ask earlier. Do we lose the Facility Conservation Improvement Project funds in waiting?
That's a good question. I doubt it. I mean, the funding is, in essence, our funding. It's a question as to whether we can utilize the general contractor that we use through the FCIP program under that. We'll just need to check. I'm not sure I have a good answer for you. We'll check and see. We can, let me say this, if we can't use those here, I have a feeling we could probably identify another place we could use those funds. We just, ideally, it complemented this project
Sure.
very well.
Okay. Thank you.
Executive session.
Again, I will bring it back to the commission for action. Being that there is none, this dies for lack of action.
Mayor, I'd move we recess into executive session for 30 minutes to discuss with legal counsel matters subject to the attorney-client privilege for the reason that public discussion of those matters would waive the privilege and adversely affect the city's interest in the matters, and reconvene in this room at 5:04 p.m.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we... I'm sorry, 6.
6:04. It's 6:04.
6:04.
6:04.
I was trying to help him. It's been moved... It's been moved and seconded that we recess into executive session. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed say nay. We will reconvene in this room at 6:04. Do you expect any action?
Yes, we do, Mayor.
There will be action. We will reconvene at 6:04.
By the way, we got our
We're back in executive session.
Mayor, I move that the commission acknowledge the withdrawal of the Session Law Firm as the city's environmental counsel for the forming Schilling Air Force Base matter and authorize the city manager to engage environmental counsel in concert with the other local public entities involved in the matter.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we acknowledge this withdrawal as presented. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay. Motion passes 4-0. Is there any other business?
Mayor, I make a motion we adjourn.
Second.
So it's been moved and seconded that we adjourn. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed say nay. We are adjourned. Thank you.